If you don't get to see me, you can see my pink blouse. At that much, at least, you can reach out to. All that introduction which was given about me is not what I am so much. I'm ultimately a Sunday school teacher who taught for 18 years toddlers and one fine day gave it up saying, ladies and gentlemen, you've had children, so please take over. And now it's gone from the toddlers to the teens. I teach teens. That's one of the jobs that I do. Anyway, this morning I want to really appreciate Ratnakar and the team who've done a fabulous job of many things. And I was amazed. You know, I go to speak at places. Yeah, that's worth it. Yeah. I go to speak at places where I put the tables, I put the projector, I put the microphone. Sometimes I carry microphone with me because my voice is one of my struggle areas. So when I saw all this overwhelming information, including the seating arrangement being displayed in front of me, I was like, man, the day belongs to the one who's prepared, but these guys are way beyond preparation. I honor God for your excellence. I honor God for your faithfulness in doing things. So to straight away take away from there, you know, from the survey that was done for expectations, questions, and the kind of people, the audience that we are going to have, I want to just pick on some of them. Ratnakar, I want to say I sat and read each one of them line to line. So it was honorable that you did it, and we just didn't leave it as another file you sent us. Yeah. Some of the expectations people have expressed is getting new ideas to influence the marketplace, how we create an impact in the workplace. I need to learn how to grow professionally on the inside and make an impact on the outside. Biblical principles I need to follow. How to be impactful, not just being another person at work. Stories and practical insights. Why I picked some of these few and not all of them, I felt they were relevant in what I was going to focus and speak on. And I believe these are your expectations which will get met, and rest of the expectations expressed by you will get met when the rest of the speakers come, okay? And I'm so glad. Can I have a show of arms of all the women here? I'm not a feminist. Okay, yeah, you know, first time I've had more number of women in a conference than men. It's a start of so many firsts. Can you imagine? I don't want to lose out on what prophetically God is doing. You know, my speech is there, time is not getting wasted, we'll get to that, yeah? But I think prophetically God is doing something in this city. Turn to your neighbor and say, you are here for such a time as this. A extremely well-behaved audience, my Lord. I'm used to everybody being just noisy with me, okay? And the other thing which I saw was, amongst the various, like he said, 17 industries represented, I saw that IT and ITES was 38%, school and education was 7%, business was 4%, Christian organizations was 4%, L&D was 3%, then travel, tourism, hotels was 3%, manufacturing was about 7%, and non-profit social enterprises was 2%. That's about 66% of the population. That's where my experiences come from. So for that 66% of the population, I will cater to. Okay, the rest of the 34, look to another three speakers who will speak. I'm just setting all my, you know, disclaimers and defaulters right at the beginning. But also, honestly, I wanted to pick on all that these gentlemen have done. What a fabulous job. You can't afford to overlook, okay? So, having said that, let me start with a little element of, influence for me as a family, for us as a family. You know, I was born and bred and read, and I was fed in Chennai as a Tam Bram girl just feeding on Thair Sadam, okay? That was me, yeah? I grew up as a just simple town girl, and then of course work has taken me everywhere. I married a man. You find three things all over the world. You can go search the internet and find out what are those three things. One of those I'll mention now, okay? So I married a man who was born and brought up in Bihar, in a place called Khargol, which I never knew till I got married, okay? Though I was brilliant at geography, and by the way, I have a graduation degree in geography. I had not looked at that place, okay? Malayali, born and brought up in Bihar, who spoke Bhojpuri and a total carnivore. And I came from a Tambram family, totally vegetarian, not even vegan, that's the new term, yeah, no, vegetarian, and I got married to this man. And he spoke Bhojpuri, Hindi and English and Malayalam, and I spoke Tamil and English. You know, we grew up at a time when we didn't learn Hindi. Till today, I don't know Hindi, okay? And my husband has a sister who again grew up in the same place, and she's married to a Gujarati who speaks Marathi in Bombay. And we have a nephew who neither speaks Malayalam, Tamil, Gujarati or Bhojpuri, just speaks English. What a confluence of influence of the diversity in this country that God has had in our life. And if for each of you, maybe there are stories like that to come up with. And this morning I want to say, I stand here having just experienced the influence of God in multiple ways, even when I was not a follower of Jesus, as well as when I started to follow Jesus. And having said that, you know, my first assignment in all of my work, I went to a school called as Oberoi Center for Learning and Development. Okay, it's supposed to be one of the premier hotel institutes in this country. And by the way, I don't come from a catering college. Like all South Indian homes, my mother and father made me really study. Okay, I did my pre-doctoral in social development. For due to various other reasons, I had to get an assignment. So I went for this interview and I somehow, by God's grace, I came first in the South Zone and I got selected to go do a job I never understood. Just like this in a ballroom, 200 of us selected for various programs of OCLD were sitting there, and I still remember, this was 30 years ago, I still remember the dean of OCLD, Sunil Juneja, standing there, and the words that he spoke into us till today has a huge influence in my life. These were the words that he said. He said, when the world is at leisure and pleasure, you're going to be working. Get ready for that. There is nothing like weekend. There's no Friday evening to Sunday and Monday blues. You will have 7-day blues. That's it. And you know, invariably when I look back now, having worked for so many years, I think weekends, I really work overtime than the weekdays. You know, it's like all the weekends are, that's had a huge influence in my life. And I've said, words have the power to influence us. And it started there. Okay, having said that, with my focus going to be on, you know, influence at the sphere that we are in, so I'm going to define influence not by what I understand, what I believe, what I wrote. It's been written by Ken Blanchard, one of our favorite authors, and you will see it being repeated in Mohan's slide also, so don't think we copied each other's slide. It's just that we believe in the same thing. So influence, according to me, is any time you seek to influence a thinking, behavior or development of another. That's where I'm going to stop. Mohan will continue with your taking on the role of a leader. Yeah? I'll allow it to sink in for 5 seconds. According to this definition, can I see a show of arms? How many of you are leaders? If there are any mother housewives here, you are the biggest influence. So I can see your arm also. I believe this is the impact God has for each one of us. He's called each one of us to be an influencer. There's no big deal. It's not a formula. Every day we influence a thinking. Like today, maybe at the end of the day, I would have at least influenced a thinking of one person. I would have at least encouraged behavior change for one person. And I'm sure when Mohan comes up, he will probably, you know, actually trigger large element of development for a large number of you. Having said that, let me go on to the Bible piece. There were influences all across in the history of the Bible. Okay? And me being a woman, I picked up all the 3 women characters, not because I wanted to speak on women. And after I picked up and I put it up there, and when I got the report and I saw a large percentage of women coming, and I said, there, that's good for it to be there. The first one I want to pick up is Anna. As we see in chapter 1 of Samuel, she was distraught, didn't have children, and to add to her pain, the second wife of her husband had children. So obviously Anna prayed and said, Lord, if you give me a son, you know, like many of us do that in desperation. When I wanted to follow the Lord Jesus and I didn't know anything about him, and I didn't know much about what will happen, one of my first lines of prayer as a child not knowing Jesus was, Lord, if you help me to follow you, I will follow you all the days of my life. No issues. I think Hannah was like that in her desperation. She was not the child that she wanted to have for herself, but she wanted to make sure that the child that she has will be dedicated back to God. Yeah? And in this whole atmosphere of that she was waiting on, she prayed like crazy. This morning, I want to drive open home one idea that at our workplaces, prayer makes a huge difference, whether you like it or not. And I want to tell you, prayer is a gift you can give everybody without them asking you for it. You don't have to pray with people all the time. You can pray for them. You can pray for them at the workplace without praying with them. You can pray for them at your home. Because I believe as you begin to pray with people, God will really build love in your hearts for people. Amen? We can't love people in our own way unless we really begin to pray for them. Let me share with you my real life story. So one of the teams that I built was with an ITES company. And it was the learning and development team I was called upon to build. And by the way, with all humility, I want to stand here and tell you, I have no certification in learning and development. I have no qualification in learning and development. The Holy Spirit has been my teacher, of course, a lot of reading and a lot of attending and getting equipped, okay? So one of the girls who was working under me as I, as I invested in her life, so we went through the whole process of a premarital counseling and, getting a wedding ready and all of that. All this happened, and lo and behold, even after getting pregnant, this dear girlfriend of mine continued to smoke. And the 15th week, during this time, every day I would pray for her pregnancy in public with her, but in my private closet, I prayed that God will enable her to give up smoking because smoking kills. And at this time, it's not smoking killing one person, it might kill two. Yeah? So I used to pray every day. And one fine day at the 15th week, she came to me and she said, doctors told me to come to the hospital right away because I'm having some complications and there's going to be some abnormalities and maybe probably I may not be able to continue with this pregnancy. And she said, can you pray with me? And always at workplaces, be open in your way you do things. So I said, all my other friends were there who were friends of other faith. I said, anybody wants to pray to the God you believe in, please pray. Yeah, then all of them turned and said, no, Jaya, you pray. I think she wants you to pray in the God you believe in. Okay, we just did a short prayer. You don't have to have long prayers calling from Genesis to Revelation, all the verses. Okay, we said, Lord, this is a gift from you. We call upon you right now. Remember your good mercies and would you just come and touch her womb and you will keep the child. Leanne goes back to the doctor. And the doctor says, oh, everything is fine. Don't have to worry. As much as the story could stop there, my dear girlfriend continued smoking. Because God had come through once, right? And there's somebody who's praying all the time. So it's okay to continue smoking. And for me, it was not her who was in the test of trial. I was in the test of trial. Because I genuinely loved the people who worked with me, always. Okay, and I continued praying. And I want to thank God this morning, 21st week, she cut through with a smoking habit. Today she has a 7-year-old daughter, absolutely normal, and she doesn't smoke anymore. So I believe prayer has a huge impact on people, and that's the first thing I want to tell you. Secondly, second influencer was Mary Magdalene. In Mark, when you go see it, just for letting you know some scriptures I know, okay? Jesus introduces Mary Magdalene as Mary Magdalene, out of whom demonic spirits were cast out. What an introduction. Unlike the gentleman who introduced me, here was Jesus introducing Mary Magdalene in Mark towards the end. Here is this woman out of whom 7 demonic spirits were cast out. And we also know at one particular time she comes and breaks this whole jar of fabulous perfume. Can you imagine? It says it was an yearly wage. I want to just ask you to visualize for a second. A yearly wage of $1 million you're coming and consecrating at the foot of Jesus. Visualize. And don't tell me, Jaya, don't compare. Those days what happened and current days what's happening, that's our preciousness, right? Large amounts of money is our preciousness very often. Yeah, she comes and breaks everything. And of course, there are guys who are around her, around Jesus saying, hello, she's wasting it. Let her to stop it. But of course, Jesus reprimands them, gives them, you can go read the story. And we wouldn't be talking about her if her aroma of fragrance hadn't started spreading at that point in time at Jesus' feet. I want to ask you this morning, how many of you are an aroma of fragrance at your workplace? And you're probably thinking position, authority, scope of work, the organization makes a huge difference for me to be the aroma of fragrance. I just want to tell you, we got to be an aroma of fragrance, and God gives us an opportunity to be an aroma of fragrance wherever we are. And you can do it in the ways God gives you as ideas. And I just went and saw all that has been put up here because we came a little early. The number of ideas that have been written, I wanted to click a picture of it and put it up there. And I said, no, I won't spoil the fun of it. You go read it. Beautiful ideas are put up there. But one of the things that that God enabled me to do at work was, you know, we worked at a time in earlier years, still when bell curve was being used. HR professionals here, everybody understands bell curve, yeah? We just made some people really get their best and the rest of the people to survive, and most of them were in PIP, performance improvement plan, you know, the exit plans. We gave it a nice name, right? In the ITES world, that's what we did. So I worked in a world like that, and one of the things that we really worked was for our teams to understand in the bell curve, it was their responsibility to make sure that if they have done well this year and they've got 25% increment, they got to make all their other team members to come to that level. You know, because bell curves never establish equality. They never plateau. It's not, bell curve is not the cross of Christ. Okay, it doesn't plateau people. It's been a huge struggle. And I want to thank God this morning that in our team, I had 4 managers reporting to me. And all the 4 managers worked with their teams. So in the 9 years that I worked in that organization, almost everybody had an opportunity to have an entire increment of 25%. And the others were willing to let go so that people will grow and their full potential will come out. And I think God will give you ideas to be the aroma of fragrance if you're willing. Third one, Esther. I know the most spoken character, most read, most prayed about, most, you know, appreciated character. She was Esther, as we know, it's Mordecai who encourages her. So good to have encouragers who push you to do things for God. And then God, clearly Esther knew for such a time as this, God had called her. And she knew one appearance in front of the king could make all the difference, but it could also cost her a life. How many of us are willing to make that one appearance in front of our bosses, even if it'll cost us our job? I really want to ask you. And many a times, let me tell you, when you start influencing, with it follows the most spoken word of today in the Christendom, persecution. When you start being an influence, persecution will follow. Okay? So one of the things that happened was God was helping me to influence friends of other faith in my teams. And one girl came from the M world. Because this is being recorded, I'm using certain words and you have to catch on, or offline you can ask me, okay? One of the girls came from the M world, and after 3 years of investment, God enabled me. One night at 3 o'clock in the morning, she calls me because they know I wake up at 4 o'clock to pray. 3 o'clock she calls me and she says, can you just give me the gospel? I want to accept Lord Jesus Christ as my Savior. I'm like, what? You know, I'm like in the graveyard hour. Gone are the days of hotel working. Right now, I'm quite normal. And of course, I run through the entire gospel with her because much had been spoken before. And she accepts the Lord Jesus Christ. Lo and behold, after that, long story short, she goes through the waters of baptism. And at that point of time, the company, I've always worked in companies which are not Christian. Okay, neither in principle nor in ownership, nor in promotership, anything, okay, fine. And the moment she went through waters of baptism, the father imprisoned her at home, and I went on an Esther fast. She was one of my best performers. I said, Lord, let her not come back. I'm okay to work, but I'm trusting that you're going to release her from this prison. No way all this is happening for her to be imprisoned. And lo and behold, on the fourth day, they took her out of home and they took her back to their religious head to reinduct her back into the religion which they believed. And these were the words of the religious head. The religious head said, the spirit in her is too strong. We can't reinduct her. Please take her back. And today I want to honor God because of prayer. Honestly, I don't do anything very well except praying. And probably I'll weep when I say that. That's the only thing I really do well. Yeah? And today, by God's grace, she and her husband actually pastor a church now. When we pray and when we believe, I'm telling you, God will really do what he has to do. Okay, all said and done, good for women. The men are getting bored now. Let's move on, yeah? All the rest of the examples are going to be men. Hooray? Yeah? Okay, for some of them principles, I didn't see the survey before. Only we saw the survey day before night. But I had done my PowerPoint much before that and I had done my preparations and I was amazed somebody had put there, can we know the principles of influence? And there was a slide, okay? Firstly, all of us have influence. Like 1 Corinthians chapter 1 verses 27 to 29, paraphrased version if I tell you, God picked up who are foolish, who are unwise, who are not the best of the Lord, not the creme de la creme, to be the ones who will shun the wise. So that means, anything of human wisdom is not going to be the people picked up, but all of us as people seated here are created for influence. Can you tell your neighbor, I'm here to influence you? Hey, I'm a very neighboring girl. You have to talk more. Yeah? You can't be. Okay, tell each other, we're going to influence the city of Bangalore. Hey, that you can do louder once again. We're going to influence the city of Bangalore. Amen. We are going to influence this country, this nation of India. Yeah? Do you believe that? Yeah? Because something happened on October 6, 2018 year in this ballroom, much will start rolling out. Remember that. It's not without a purpose. Secondly, I am to use the influence given to me. I have to use the influence because most of your arms went up for the definition which I put up. That means all of you have influence. Okay? So, as in Matthew very clearly says, you're called to be the salt and you're called to be the light. You cannot afford to be in the shaker all the time and make an influence. You have to come out of the shaker, okay? And sometimes maybe over salty for some people. Yeah, sometimes rather over enlightening for people because sometimes we get over passionate, right? Yeah, but as yet, God wants each one of us to be the salt and light. And don't wait for that perfect day when I'll become the salt and light. By then, your preservation is gone. Start where you are, okay? But I believe grace of God will walk in each day for us to be. Thirdly, I'm to steward the influence given to me. Remember the parable of the talents? I believe here everybody is well read in the theology on Bible and everything, okay? So the guy was given, obviously doubled it, made it into 5 more. The guy was given 2, made it 4. But the guy who was given 1 said, my master, nah, very hard guy. So let me just hide it under the carpet. But you know, one of the gospels, beautifully it says, those who proved that they were good, that they really multiplied, they were made responsible for cities. And I think your church vision, one of the elements is really mission into cities. And if each of you seated are really influencing with the talents given in your hand. And by the way, Rick Warden did research when he wrote the Purpose-Driven Life. And one of the research statistics that he found out was each of us have been blessed by 100 talents. If you're sitting there thinking, oh, only there are few speakers. By the way, speakers are those, okay? I'm not a speaker. Thank God I'm not an inanimate thing, yeah? Fine? Yeah, and can you imagine 700 talents? And if you're thinking you don't have any, that means you're telling God you made a junk of me. God made it beautiful for each one of us to use 700 of our talents. Fourthly, I'm to serve and give as I influence others. Remember, Jesus in Matthew chapter 20 says, the leaders lorded over all. And then the verses go on to say, not so with you. The Son of Man came to serve and not to be served. I believe God is, if you want to influence people, God is looking for foot washers and not roof crashers. You know, in the Bible, only once, okay, in the multiple Gospels, the 4 friends dropping down that paralytic friend is mentioned. Am I right? Yeah? But foot washing is mentioned more than once. And so much for the guy who started cell group in his house, he was roofless. Yeah, God doesn't want us to be people who will make people's homes roofless, but he definitely wants us to be people who can wash people's feet. And you may be thinking, how do we do that? It's not easy. Start where you are. Not so with you. Tell your neighbor, not so with you. Hey, come on, be convinced about it, yeah? It's like just because you're saying it, Jaya, we are saying it, yeah? And also tell your neighbor, I'm here to serve you. Yeah? That each of you told the other, it became a you know, mutual understanding. Good to be a mutual admiration community in serving. Okay? A lot of other things we are very mutually admiring, but I think in serving, if you can get caught with it, great. Okay? So having set the principles, I'm just going to go on and end in the next... Hey, what's happened to the time monitor here? It's become 00, yeah? Yeah? So I want to go on to the next three elements from three personalities in the Bible with my own life stories as to what is important for us to be a people of influence. The first person, required element, competence, skills and excellence and diligence, okay? I really want to let you know that this is foundational for us at work, okay? But competence only supports influence, okay? I'll come to another element, the next one, okay? Competence supports influence. You know, we have to give our 100% at work. God taught me from the beginning of times. He taught me one thing. Jaya, take me into your work before you give me to others. I don't go to work to be an evangelist. I go to work to work. And when they see you work really well, and when they see you really, you know, competent at what you're doing, believe me, they will be curious to know how you're doing it. Yeah? Take God to your workplace before you give God to your friends. You know, Colossians 3:23, most spoken verse in all professional conferences. Work it with all your heart, the all your heart principle. Then Ecclesiastes 9:10 says, whatever your hands find to do, do it with all your might. The Almighty God is telling us, do it with all your might. That means put all that you have into it. And then Proverbs 22:29 says, do you see a man skilled in his work? He will serve before kings. He will not serve before obscure men. You know, one of my friends had a meeting with a CMD of a particular organization, which is pretty large. And, you know, I got an opportunity to pray with that friend. And I said, hey, what an opportunity. Whether you get this job or not, it doesn't matter to me. But can you imagine at his cost, in his workplace, at the cost of his time, you're called to go speak to him, seeing if there is a position available, and visualize, you get an opportunity to share God's love with him. Whoa. And when you are good at things, God will take you to people like that. Yeah. And also, if you look at Daniel, he was a man of great influence. That's why we are speaking about him even today. How do we know he was a man of great influence? The first king under whom he worked, Nebuchadnezzar, said this. In every matter of wisdom and understanding about which the king questioned them, that is Daniel and his three amigos. You know the three amigos? Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. Okay, Abednego. Okay? Training period. Every matter about what the king questioned them, he found them 10 times better than all the magicians and the enchanters in his whole kingdom. 10 times better. I know we don't like comparative words. Am I really proving the best for God in my workplace? Am I the one people will run to, look up to and say, hey, that's the one who will give the solutions. Let's go. And I'll tell you something. The solutions don't come because of intelligence. The solutions come from the God, Lord, Almighty. The Holy Spirit gives you the solutions. And that's what Daniel did. Remember, Daniel was serving in a pagan nation under a pagan king with a pagan name, with having learned all the pagan literature. It was not an easy place. And then the following king after Nebuchadnezzar, Darius says, now Daniel so distinguished amongst the administrators and the stirrups by the exceptional qualities that the king planned to set him over the whole kingdom. Okay? They recognized that he had more competence than anybody. And remember, Daniel just landed in the kingdom of pagans as a prisoner of war, maybe somewhere between teenage and a little bit older. Yeah? And he didn't go to the lion's den till 80 plus. Okay? Daniel didn't have an extremely fruitful life, if you see. Every day he kneeled and prayed towards Jerusalem thrice a day, and Bible never tells us he ever went to Jerusalem. But still, Daniel continued to serve with all his competence in a kingdom where he was not even a majority. Can you imagine a minority guy was picked up to be the lead in the kingdom? Competence, that's what it does to you. And I want to encourage you this morning. Daniel acknowledged God who revealed these mysteries and dreams, as I spoke, shared with you. He knew only God holds the future and nobody else. Daniel was humble, fasted often, prayed frequently, obeyed God despite the consequences. Remember the three friends telling the king, our God will come through. Even if our God doesn't come through, we are not going to bow down. Look at and right in chapter 1, we read about Daniel. He resolved in his heart. There was a resolution that he passed for himself, and he said, I'm not going to skip the boundaries. I'm going to stick to what God is telling me to do. Yeah? God allowed him to know things that others didn't know. Who does God make known his secrets to? Who does God make known his secrets to? His children? Some a little more specific? To his friends. I've called you my friends and I make known my secrets to you. And I believe if you have an intimacy with God, you will understand the heart of God for your workplace. Yeah? Next character, required element, character. Next character, and I said character. Yeah? Before I go to the Joseph element, let me give you a quick story on how competence helped me to influence my workplace. One of the places I worked was all first-generation workers, and we were building a learning and development team. And every trainer who came to be hired was hired by me after the Holy Spirit said, hire. And I wouldn't even like their looks. I wouldn't like the way they spoke. And the Lord would say, you are in my team, not that you're the most likable one. Okay, just relax. Pick the one I'm telling you to pick. Yeah? So, you can't fight the Holy Spirit. You just got to obey. So I obeyed and I've hired people. And God enabled me to walk with each trainer who used to come to work with us for 20 weeks minimum. Handhold them and walk with them. And 21st week when they go live by themselves, they are really roaring infernos. Because they've had every encouragement, every appreciation, every feedback, every feed forward rather. And they knew they were valued because somebody was investing in them every day. That means it meant for me, sometimes night shifts, sometimes afternoon shifts, sometimes early morning shift. So I did work for 20 years only in shifts, by the way. And I'm still normal without sickness. Thank God for that. Yeah? But the whole investments that we made in people, remember, competence is for impartation, not for your next promotion. If you're keeping it for your next promotion, you will never have a tribe like you ever advancing in your workplaces. You've got to impart what God gives you. Secondly, Joseph. If you want to keep your competence levels going, you have to build your character. I told you, competence supports influence, right? Character enhances influence. Yeah? Actually, these are not anybody writing it. Yesterday, I was doing my dry run with Mohan's wife. She said, I'm not coming tomorrow. I said, please sit down. I'll do the dry run. I will deliver my message and you give me feedback. And the Holy Spirit started speaking so many things. That's where I wrote and I said, I think you're a good woman of God. Thank God for that. I got all these ideations. Yeah. Okay. So Joseph had no compromise in his values. If you look at his life, he was palmed off to the Midianites from the pit. Remember? Yeah, I'm not going to tell the story from the Midianites. But God was within him times and seasons because Joseph was caught with those two dreams which were fixed into his mind. Potiphar's wife test, remember? From the pit, it was the Potiphar's wife test. Okay? Like all of us, tempted at one time or the other. Joseph, remember, these are stories of years ago. It doesn't change. In the fallen man, it doesn't change. Okay? But right, he ensured that he practiced righteous behavior despite being falsely accused. He didn't fall to flesh and he didn't fall to false accusation. Then, of course, he goes to the prison. Nobody gets him the say with the king for him to be released. In the prison again he's taught, because everywhere Joseph goes, in one version it's written, all that he did in Pharaoh's kingdom was very good. That means the kingdom prospered because of Joseph. How many of us sitting here can say, because I walk into my workplace, the kingdom of our workplace is going to prosper? Yeah, you have the authority. You can speak that. By the word, the world was made. By your words, there can be enhancements. There can be build-ups. There can be huge bottom lines which can increase. Unbelievable, incomparable, because you worship an incomparable God. Yeah? Then going on to Joseph, Lord showed his mercy and he found favor. Suddenly from the prison, remember? He was shaved and put on new clothes and all and brought for interpretation of the dream of the king. Yeah? Lastly, after 13 years of this whole pit, Potiphar prison experience, ultimately the finale arrives when he becomes the prime minister of that place in current day, modern day terminology. He becomes the prime minister. But it took him a lot of his courage to do what he was called to do. And I want to tell you, Joseph served the audience of one. The audience of one is Jesus. Tell your neighbor, we serve the audience of one. Yay, that was loud. Thank you. Give yourselves a good hand. Yeah, because I'm a Sunday school teacher. I need all this good cheer and everything every now and then. Okay, so one of my jobs, I worked for 4 years setting up solar and wind power plants. Okay, when I joined the company, except the word and the spelling of power, I didn't know anything. So every day I would read 120 pages to understand. And you know, solar technology changes like way faster than IT. Okay, at least IT I understood. Solar, I didn't understand anything, okay? And it was so hard. Anyway, long story short, I started working. And one particular time, my promoter sent me to a particular government to negotiate something. And lo and behold, the C word which we are all scared of. You can ask me offline what is a C word. I'm also testing your intelligence. So sorry for that, yeah? Early morning, it's a sprain on your brain. Forgive me for that, yeah? The C word everybody speaks about. And my boss said, hey, if it needs to be done, let's just do it. And I said, okay, please wait. And he said, yeah, I know you'll go pray. I said, yeah, definitely I'll go pray. We are a startup, not that we have everything in life, so I better go pray. And God gave me all the idea how to put the whole development plan together. And I, with all the help of the team and everything, we put it together. And then my promoter went and presented. And obviously before that, that government, using the C word, obviously wanted a whole lot of bulk cash. And once my boss went and presented, praise be to God, without any exchange of anything required, the MOU was signed. Yeah, not that I got any stock options because of that, okay? And, you know, people told me, Jaya, how do you continue working in places like this? I said, see, God put me in this place to be a solution, not a fault finder. Please. And today, I want to proudly read the letter that this gentleman gave me in the previous assignment I worked with him. I want to say a big thank you for all your hard work, knowledge, loyalty, and time investments for your life, for helping to build the organization. I know it was not an easy journey, but your continued support made it enjoyable. I would also like to thank you for building an amazing team. Your team did a fantastic job during our aggressive ramp-up and site relocation. I really admire your work for underprivileged and hope you will continue to make positive difference in people's life. I wish you and Abraham is my husband, a joyful and prosperous new year, and sincerely hope that you will achieve all your dreams that's coming through you by positive attitude, hard work, dedication, and honesty. Keep up the good work and keep smiling. Lots of love, handwritten. It's not about me that I want to speak proudly. If God takes you to places, God will bring about the influence that He has in store for you. And I believe you stand for your character and competence. Believe me. And this gentleman, you know what I want to share with you, had made it always 6 working days in a week. All the non-operational functions had to work 6 days a week. And I start, and I was non-operational function, right? Training and development. So that means I work 6 days a week. And if you are church engaged, you know what is Saturday, right? So my equation with the pastor was like, okay, not so good, yeah? So I couldn't help it. I had to go to work. And I had Americans working with me who said, our contract is 5 days, 8 hours a day, and we are not coming on Saturday. I said, oh, good enough. Okay, so I continue working. And through the 3 years, the first 3 years I was there, we did a program by Ken Blanchard called as Well Done. It's a program on redirection and reinforcement. And none of these promoters at that time were married, okay? So we started doing this because my prayer at workplace for everybody was, Lord, let them know you, let them get married, let them have a family. Because family is the base unit of any community, and if that happens, community will grow. That was my understanding always, and so I prayed that. And lo and behold, after we did this 3 years of appreciative inquiry through Well Done, suddenly one fine day we decided we'll become a 5-day working week organization. And obviously, that boss was a Marwadi. You know, Marwadis and Jews will give you 1 rupee and they expect 10 rupees out of you. Okay, fine. That's a good business strategy. Nothing wrong. And my husband works with a Jew and I always work most often with Marwadi. So we are a great combination like that. Okay, we don't treat people like that. So don't get worried. So so at last, when he changed, the first thing the next financial year he did was, let's see how the bottom line has got affected. And that was 2008. You know what happened in 2008, right? Yeah, and I said, Lord, I know I influenced for so long, and why did this change happen? You could have continued working 6 days. Is it going to backfire on me and everything? But I want to give glory to God. That year, we had a gross margin profit of 70%. And everybody in the organization got 12% increments. And people like us chose to, all the senior management said, we don't want the 12% increment. Nobody left the job. ITES I'm talking about, where attrition was 90 days. You identify with me, yeah? But God was so gracious in the job and I worked. Minimum period that people served us was 4 years. And I had people serving with me for 7 years and 9 years. Not that they couldn't get other jobs, but they were really growing in the organization that we are. I believe character and competence, that's what it is. Lastly, I cannot forget but to do the compassion piece. At work, compassion piece is so important. Firstly, I want to tell you, the Good Samaritan, what did he do? He saw the guy slain on the road. Obviously, he was a Jew because those days, 17 miles journey between Jericho and Jerusalem was every 2 weeks. The priests went to serve in Jerusalem and they were returning. If you go read the history of it, okay? And obviously, this man sees it. Everybody else passes by. He not only sees him, he has compassion. He dresses up his wounds, pours the olive oil on it. He bandages it. Then also uses his Airbus 300. The donkey to transport the man. And I'm sure the guy's blood and everything came on the donkey, which was not a good thing. And he was risking his life. Remember, a Jew and the Samaritan. And lo and behold, he takes him to the inn, not only pays for the stay then, pays further also and tells him, I'll come back and repay. And when the rich young man asked Jesus, what should I do in that parable story? Jesus says, go and do likewise. And I want to tell you, go and do likewise. And how are we going to do it? Make loving others your priority. Okay? Like very clearly, John 1 John 3:11 says, this is the message you have heard from the beginning. We should love one another. You know, as your MC for the morning shared, what's your name? Yeah, Brian. Sorry, Brian. I'm just calling you MC. I don't like calling people. Sorry, Brian. Brian, I should have found out before. Forgive me. Brian said, yes, my girl, I saw the green paper. I can't see the time, but though, okay? So Brian said, you know, Jaya and her husband maintain an open home. I want to tell you, we opened our home to be really open to others. And one of the times, all the people who come and live with us are friends of other faith, and they are not Christians. So one of the first few girls who came to live with me was a girl whose father had really, you know, treated her badly. She came and lived with us for 5 months. Okay? How was Abraham and I making loving her the priority in our home? My husband and I are married for 25 years. We don't have biological children. So as much as we keep our home open, so as soon as this girl came to live, we wanted to make sure no cases come against us. So to the police station, I went and registered an FIR first. Because a father could put a case against us saying, you know, there's other illicit things happening in this home. So I take care of the legal bits first, and then she continued living with us. When they come to live with us, beloved, they do life with us. That means if we go for a holiday, they come with us. If we go for a movie, they come with us. Every morning, can you imagine, she was working in my team, and I would go at a different hour to work. I would pack her food every morning, all her clothes washed, ironed, because she was depressed also. So all of it you take care. I'm not saying I did it all. When you pray, God will give you the love for others, and loving others will become your priority. And I want to tell you, everything is not a success story. This girl walked in the Lord. She came from front as a friend of other faith. She walked in the Lord for 3 years and ultimately chose to go back to her religion. But still I pray for her every day and say, Lord, the seed that has been sown cannot be robbed away. Someday it will bear its fruit. Yeah. So I want to encourage you. Can you make loving others a priority? Secondly, love values others. For God so loved the world. I don't know why that's, you know, most unexpected word so is put there. Yeah. God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son. If that was what God gave us, how much more can we give our people? One of the thing about valuing others is another story of our life. We had another guy living with us for 2 years. Okay, and when you value others, no, God will bless them more than he'll bless you. Honestly, I'm telling you. So we went on this vacation. My husband had got a one-bedroom suite. Okay, and I said, oh no, this is going to be the place we are going to live. Just there, he's going to sleep in that bed and we are going to be just here. That's very harsh. Anyway, I prayed and my husband said, this is what is available. Just keep quiet. Thank God for the holiday. Okay. You know, sometimes certain things like that, reprimand is required. And I got suddenly very joyous. I said, yeah, very happy. And then the hotel called and said, ma'am, you are an international hotels group gold member. So we have another room to offer. Abe said, no, we're settled. Don't bother. I said, no, I want to go look. And then we went and looked. And lo and behold, it was a presidential suite at the same rate which we had paid for the room. 3,600 square feet. God didn't give it for us. God gave it for the guy who was living with us. That's where God really taught me lavish. When you value others, no, you don't get bothered about who's going to provide. God will provide. He is the provider. You and I are just channels of provision sometimes. Lastly, love costs. It's going to cost you your time. It's going to cost you your money. It's going to cost you your talents. Time, treasure, and talents. So as I said, high cost is equal to fulfillment. Another story of influence at work. You know, July 26th, there was a bomb blast in the trains in Mumbai. Remember? Yeah. And I get a call at 7 o'clock. And the guy who's speaking on the other end, I recognize his voice. Yes, my girl. Recognize his voice. And he says, Jaya ma'am, my brother got his MBA degree from IES University. And he was traveling in the train in Jogeshwari. He got blown out. And his sister used to work for me. She came till 1 o'clock in the morning. I sat with her. She's crying. She's doing everything. I'm not a grief counselor by profession. I listened to all of it. At 1 o'clock in the night, with two more of my colleagues, we drive to the morgue of the government hospital in which the body was. We pick up the body. And then my dear girlfriend, Nilima, says, hey, Jaya, can we look for the hand with that watch? I said, Nilima, thank God his body and his head is there. We can't fight for arms and legs now. The morgue was like mass. You don't know who's who. Yeah? We pick up the body. They give it to us in a sack. Can you imagine? We come to the parents' home. Nobody in the parents' home. The three of us, two more girls and another guy who drove the car for us at 1 o'clock. And we go back there and give it there. And we stay with the parents. We encourage and we pray. You may ask me, Jaya, after doing all this, are they following Jesus? The answer is no. Remember one thing, we have word ministry where we preach the gospel, but we also have deed ministry where we do the faith by deeds. And it's only God knows whether they come into the kingdom or not. Okay? I want to end by letting you know, if you can be a people of influence just where you are with the things that God has given you, your competence, your character, your compassion, may I ask you in your little pads to write down, which one do you desire the most? Compassion, character, competence. Do you want to be a prayerful Anna Do you want to be an aroma of fragrance like Mary Magdalene? Or do you want to be an Esther who was raring and daring and risk-taking? As you write that, I want to pray and close. Father, we thank you for this morning. Thank you for speaking into our hearts. We pray, seal what you've sown in the good soil. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.